Greetings and blessings to each one that takes the time to watch this video. I want to talk today a little bit about two very important themes, specifically gnosis and conscious practice. Gnosis meaning knowledge in the Greek, but encompassing a more deep meaning than how we think of it in English, and we're going to talk about that. Coming to know, realizing, revelation of truth, things of that nature. So gnosis as well as conscious practice in our lifestyle. And the reason I want to talk about these two themes is that they are themes that are, or paths that are really taught and practiced in the, sorry, my dog is whining, he's with me today. Themes that are practiced, of course, in the Gnostic Christian groups and some of the texts that we've gone over in this channel from the Nag Hammadi Library, early Christian texts, as well as the Essene tradition, the Gospel of Peace, the Gospel of the Holy Twelve, and some of the other texts from the Essene Judaism and early Christianity. And we've gone over a lot of these texts and talked about different things on this channel, so if you're interested in that, you can find videos to that on this channel. Of course, I'll link down below. I'll put a link to where you can go read all of the Nag Hammadi Library and some of the Essene texts online, so I'll put links to that. Today I want to talk about the two paths, or the importance of these understandings of what gnosis is and conscious practice, and how it provides a framework for our own spiritual path. And of course, these themes, as we talk about them, these themes can also be found, in the canonical Bible, the Christian Bible. You can find teachings to these themes in those scriptures as well. And I'm sure for those familiar with the canonical Bible, you'll see that as we go through this. So first of all, I want to talk about an important theme, which is salvation, because these have been described before. Both gnosis and conscious practice as paths to salvation. And so we have to first talk about salvation a little bit, because from a kind of mainstream Christian lens, in terms of what salvation has come to mean in our minds, it doesn't capture really what we're talking about, because oftentimes salvation has been reduced to this afterlife phenomenon. In other words, what do I have to do in order to go to heaven instead of hell? When in reality, salvation is really missed if we think of it only in this framework. Because salvation, of course, the Greek word for salvation is sozo, which means complete deliverance from all negative effect in our lives. It's a very much here and now thing. Where I heard someone say that Christianity was the first religion that invented the need for salvation. And I think there's a fragment of truth in that, as if it comes down to the idea of what belief system do I need, or what do I need to do in order to one day go to heaven instead of hell, and it only deals with the afterlife. There's some truth to that, but in reality, most spiritual paths concern themselves with salvation in the terms of deliverance from the negative effect in our lives, and that's certainly what Christ was about. And I think we'll see that if we really look into it, that it's not only about this afterlife phenomenon, which makes it easy to have a little religious thing and trust in one day I'll go here instead of here, but then live our lives any kind of way, in a way that doesn't really deliver us from our suffering or the suffering of others or bring about transformation in our lives. So salvation meaning this total deliverance from negative effect, it means that as we walk down the paths of this transformative process, specifically in regards today, we're referring to it as gnosis, or coming to know the truth, and conscious practice, we're walking down this path where we are beginning to, through these things that Christ brings, escape from negative ways of operating, negative things that hold us back, that cause anxiety, depression, hopelessness, or causing harm to ourselves or others in various ways. It's this process, this path of salvation, where we are trading out death for life in the here and now and becoming better versions of ourselves according to the eternal purpose of God, for us to be sons and daughters of God, children of light, in this life on this earth. So let's define the terms briefly Gnosis means, of course, knowledge. And there's a lot of emphasis in some of the canonical writings and sayings of Jesus and teachings that are in the Bible, as well as definitely in the Nag Hammadi library and other texts that come from Christian groups that could be defined as Gnostic, coming, of course, from Gnosis. There's this heavy theme on realizing truth as a means of setting us free and bringing about God's purpose for us. And it's a very revelatory approach. And one main difference between the word gnosis and the English word knowledge is that in the English language, the word knowledge is often, it could be head knowledge. It could be, oh, I know this information. But I love the Greek word gnosis. Sorry, my dog again. I love the Greek word gnosis because it actually means to come to know or to realize. It talks about an experiential reality where through a process of revelation, you're actually coming to realize something or coming to know it. It's a more spiritual process. It's not something you can read about in a book, but it's something that comes from direct experience, direct encounter. It's a more spiritual reality where we come to realize or come to know something that shifts our paradigm, shifts our understanding. While we pray, while we meditate, while we study, it's this quickening work of the Spirit that causes us to get something, to realize something, to come to know, and it sets us free. And of course, it reminds me of the statement that Jesus made where he said, get to know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And so when we get these direct experiences, direct encounters, as we're on this path of seeking and growing in a spiritual sense, not just a head knowledge sense, as we practice and as we seek and as we're in the presence of God, etc., and we come to know things, we come to know truth, then the truth sets us free and it breaks the pattern, negative thought patterns, false patterns. My dog again. He sees another dog. It breaks the negative thought patterns that cause our own suffering. It breaks the false things that we believe or think or feel. And we transcend those and we experience deliverance just by this process of coming to realize and coming to know. So that's the word gnosis, which is a heavy theme in some of the texts we've covered here and many others, as well as the canonical Bible. And it's an important element of our faith to transcend this head knowledge thing, or ascribing to a certain set of beliefs, or jumping through a religious hoop and securing our afterlife. We realize salvation is in the here and now. It comes through this minute-by-minute walk and growth spiritually, where things come alive to us and we become alive as we realize and come to realize and come to know. Gnosis. So the other thing that is some of the early Christian groups that could be described Gnostic, of course, also teach this conscious practice thing that I want to talk about next. But what I really have benefited from is the tradition of the Essenes, Essene Judaism, where Yeshua, Jesus, came from, and John the Baptist, and of course, birthed early Christianity in general. So there's so much richness in the Essene Judaism, which we know so much about because of the Dead Sea Scrolls, other texts from the Essene tradition, the Gospel of Peace, the Gospel of the Holy Twelve. And it emphasizes something that has really changed my life in so many ways, which is the necessity of conscious practice. You know, it kind of takes this gnosis or coming to realize truth thing. It takes it and it brings it into a very practical lifestyle. And on the subject of salvation, we have to realize that our own lifestyle, our own practice, impacts our own freedom. It impacts everything about us. I like to say sometimes that knowledge doesn't do much good unless it's practiced. Everything comes down to practice. You can know all this stuff about something, but how does it affect how you think? How does it affect how you live? How does it affect various choices? And I personally am on this path where I constantly try to make even the smallest choices in a more conscious direction. Everything from how I treat others, how I treat myself, how I live my day-to-day life, what I eat, what I consume in media, what I put out there, how I speak, what difference I'm making each moment. I try to constantly upgrade those in small ways, and it's a continual process. But in the process of doing that, which we see taught in the Essene tradition, is that our own conscious practice, as we get to know the truth about things and apply it to choices we make in our life, it again brings about this salvation or deliverance from negative effect, because we begin to eliminate the reasons or the actions or the thoughts that we continually make that causes our suffering or the suffering of others. And it begins to bring about this salvation process, not only in ourself, but also in the world around us, because everything we do has an effect. And it's not to say, going back to the traditional Christian perspective, it's not to say that we're doing all of these things, or these good works, if you will, in order to get this approval that will bring about salvation in the sense of, oh, now God will accept me into heaven instead of hell. It's not about that. It's all about the here and now, realizing the kingdom of God here and now that's within us, that we're working on bringing forth. So I'm not doing these good works just to get approved or to get my ticket stamped to heaven, if you will, but it's more about realizing this truth that's setting me free and applying it to my life. So I don't just have this intellectual faith and framework and then I come up with all the other details of my life, but rather my life is becoming infused with the kingdom of heaven, the law of light, as it's sometimes called, bringing forth that light which is within me into the actual actions I make, which sets me free and the world around me. And so if we realize the importance of this path, what it comes down to is it encourages us to have a picture of what our life looks like, what our spirituality looks like, what our spiritual life looks like, what our faith walk looks like, however you want to define it. But it causes us to realize where our salvation lies, if you will. Again, not in the afterlife sense, but in this process of sozo, deliverance of negative effect or suffering for us and for others. And we realize that our life really, that's what our life becomes. It becomes a combination of practicing or positioning ourselves to be in the presence of God, to be in prayer, to be in meditation, to be in thankfulness, gratitude, to be in a posture of receiving things from the Spirit, and giving ourselves to that, as well as things like studying and surrounding ourselves with revelatory information from others. And all of these tools become a part of our life so that we can realize things, so we can keep progressing in what we are coming to know and realize in terms of truth, that the eyes of our understanding are being enlightened, if you will, that we come to know, as the Apostle Paul said in Ephesians. That the eyes of our understanding are being enlightened, so we're coming to realize, that's gnosis, coming to realize who we are, our identity, and all things pertaining to us and God. So it's a process. It's not in one day, oh, I've accomplished this. It's just a process of dedicating ourselves to being in the presence of God through different spiritual practices, etc. Study, prayer, meditation, all those things, whatever it is for each one, so that we come to realize things. But then we don't just leave our realizations in that little 1 hour time that we spent, but it becomes a lifestyle. It infuses our lifestyle. We begin to live consciously, realize the impact of how we think, the impact of what we do in all these things, and to get excited about being transformed in every part of who we are, and beginning to express that differently. Everything we come to realize, we find practical ways to express that into our life to cause less suffering to ourselves and to others, and to bring about the kingdom of heaven in and through us. So that's kind of some things that I wanted to share, maybe to give some definition to some terms, to give some understandings of what's being talked about in the Nag Hammadi Library, in the Dead Sea Scrolls, in the Essene tradition, as well as some of the canonical scripture. So we can understand that and be encouraged in our walk. So that's what I hope this does. I encourage you to continue in conscious spiritual practice, getting closer to God, being transformed by the renewing of our mind. You see my dog in the background. Simba, say hi. No. To be transformed by the renewing of our mind, and to be transformed in our lifestyle so that the Spirit is the spirit that's within us is now governing everything pertaining to our lives and the world. No pressure, it doesn't happen overnight, but if we can take small steps in that direction, giving ourselves more over to the spirit every day and practicing better and better every day and realizing that that really does bring about peace, joy, and the state of right being in us and the world around us. So those are my thoughts. I hope it encourages you. Be blessed abundantly. Be encouraged. Much love and much light. Until next time.